Blackstone presents Aphrodite's Island by Hilary Green. This book is read by Ana Clements. Author's note. In the years between the end of this story and the present day, much has changed in northern Cyprus. With the influx of tourists, there has been a great deal of development, not all of it sympathetic. Readers hoping to follow Cressida's footsteps may be disappointed to find how much commercialization has altered the landscape. Part 1. The British Colony of Cyprus, 1955. Chapter 1. The soldiers came to our village just as we were finishing the midday meal. They told all the men and boys over 12 to go to the village square. Then they started searching the houses. They were all large men, clumsy in their heavy boots, but very young. The one who came to search our house, who seemed a little older than the others, was blonde, his skin reddened by the sun. He seemed embarrassed by what he had to do. To our great surprise, he spoke to my mother in Greek. "Forgive me, Kyria. I have to carry out my orders. It will not take long." I said, "Who do you think you are, bursting in here, turning everything upside down? You are supposed to be here to protect us, to keep the peace, not to terrorize innocent women and children." He looked at me and smiled and said, "I think it would take more than the British Army to terrorize you, Thespina. I promise I will not turn anything upside down, or if I do, I will put it back again." "But what are you doing with my husband and my sons?" my mother cried out, with tears in her eyes. He said gently, "Do not worry, Kyria. They are quite safe. We just need them out of the way for a few minutes. When the search is over, they can come home again." "What are you looking for anyway?" I demanded. He said, "I think you know the answer to that. 2 days ago, someone threw a bomb at a British Army lorry. Someone is hiding bomb-making equipment somewhere, and we have to find it." "Do you really think," I exclaimed, "that you are going to find bomb-making equipment in my mother's oven?" He smiled at me again. "No, Thespina. I'm sure no terrorist would dare to take such a liberty with you to reckon with." But he searched the kitchen just the same, and the rest of the house, though I have to admit he didn't make a mess. Later, when the soldiers had gone, my brothers pulled the oilskin bag with the rifles in it up out of the well and returned them to their hiding place under the floorboards. The soldiers are everywhere in the city, driving around in their armored cars, manning checkpoints. When they are off duty, they stand on the street corners or sit in the bars, watching the girls go by. Sometimes they call out to us. We do not answer, of course. We have our reputations to consider, and the anger of our fathers and brothers. Then, a few days ago, "Thespina Ariadne." I did not recognize the voice. I looked around. To me, at that time, all British soldiers looked the same. "Thespina Ariadne." He was running across the road towards me. It would have been rude to turn away, having once stopped and looked round. "You remember me?" "Of course. It was you who searched our house." I spoke coldly, with dignity. "Yes." His eyes were very blue, and he looked at me appealingly, like a small boy who knows he has done wrong. "Don't be angry with me, Thespina. You know I have to carry out my orders." "You are wasting your time," I said. "You found nothing." As I spoke, there was a tremble of fear in my stomach, thinking what he might have found if he had come at another time. He smiled. "But it was not a waste of time. After all, I met you, Thespina Ariadne." "How do you know my name?" "It was easy. I asked someone, 'Who is the beautiful girl with the black hair and the proud walk who lives in the house near the church?' And they said, 'Ah, that is Thespina Ariadne, the schoolmaster's daughter.'" His eyes were teasing me. I saw that the skin of his face was no longer red and sore-looking, but tanned a light gold, and without his army cap, his hair was almost silver in the sunlight. I knew I should not be standing here talking to a British officer in the public street, but I did not know how to get away. He went on. "I did not expect to see you."
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.